So following this screening of Best Summer Ever, I am very excited to have with us incredible members of the film that are here with us to answer some questions and discuss how this wonderful musical was made and how the production was created and came to life. So I would like to introduce the members of the film that we have with us today. I'm gonna start with co-directors, Lauren Smitelli and Michael Parks Randa. Hi, Lauren, hi, Michael.
Hello. Thanks for having us, hope you all enjoyed the film.
I would like to introduce the producer and screenwriter of Best Summer Ever, Andrew Pilkington. Thank you for being with us, Andrew.
Hi, thank you.
And we have the stars of the film, Shannon DeVido. Thank you so much for being with us.
Thank you so much for having me.
And Rickey Wilson Jr., pleasure to have you.
Yeah, pleasure to be here. Yeah, thank you guys for having me. I hope you guys enjoyed the film.
Along with the members of the filmmaking team, we also have two other members of the production who are here to talk to us about how this film came to life. First of all, we have Will Halby, who's the founder of Zeno Mountain Farm and the executive producer of Best Summer Ever. Will, thank you so much for being with us this evening.
Thank you, nice to be here.
And we have Christine Bruno, who is an actor, activist, and was consulted on Best Summer Ever, and you might recognize her as the mechanic from the film itself. Christine, thank you for being with us this evening as well.
Thanks so much for having me.
Will, can you share with us what happened since becoming bulletproof?
Yeah, well, I think becoming bulletproof gave us the taste and smell of success, and I think we liked it, and we wanted to go big with our next production and really step it up. And I wouldn't describe, I mean, becoming bulletproof was a wonderful inclusion, but we wanted to do better on this one and include people with disabilities behind the camera as well as in front of it.
Christine, how did you get involved with Best Summer Ever?
And we, you know, had a conversation about what they were looking to do, which is what Will just said about stepping up their game and having this, you know, hugely ambitious feature length movie musical, which is ambitious for any filmmaker, you know? And I said, well, if you're looking for, you're gonna need actors who have a lot of experience. You're gonna need actors who sing, who dance, who are good actors. And so I really want to encourage you to if you haven't thought about it already, to go union with this film. And Will was like, oh, I don't know, we've never done that before. I don't even have the first idea how to do that. Because I'm also obviously a member of SAG-AFTRA. I am also on the board of the local board of SAG-AFTRA and the chair of the New York Local Performers with Disabilities Committee. And so I knew it could be done. I knew the type of contract once I knew what the approximate budget was. So I just pointed Will in the right direction and they took it from there. And that's how the film became union.
What about the musical do you think is so appealing about telling this story?
I feel like the musical is a really fun and digestible format. I think everyone goes into it with an open mind and knowing that they're going in for sort of just like a fun ride. And I think what Best Summer Ever really achieves is that lightness with this sort of like underlying message of inclusion. And I think that some of the feedback we've gotten from people who have seen it is that, you know, they kind of go into it and they've never seen that type of integration, but by the end of it, it felt so natural. And I feel like perhaps perhaps in, you know, if it was a drama or something that was a little bit more heavy-handed, perhaps that might be more noticeable. I think in this, with such a huge ensemble, we were able to sort of create something that felt really light and inclusive in that way, that it just sort of like seemed, it's something we'd always wanted to do. And I think in that, in this format, like it just really came through and people were like, they had a lot of fun, got to hear all these songs, and also like kind of had this like underlying idea kind of like growing in their head that like, wow, I've never seen a film this inclusive. And it was so fun to watch and it felt natural to see these relationships form on screen.
And we're just all obsessed with it. I think that we really wanted to exploit the things that we knew that we loved and could do. And that was something that everybody in our Zeno community is known to break out into song all the time. So.
Right. That's really true.
And I was like, as I was watching the film, I was trying to like make a list of as many references as I could to what films, you know, this kind of gives you a little homage to. So we have like Grease, there was High School Musical, I saw a little Billy Elliot in there. And I found that that was like a little cool bingo list. But one of the things that I've noticed that was really great, after the film ended, the songs were stuck in my head for a week. And I completely forgot about the originals, like Summer Lovin', you know, from Grease, which was originally kind of referenced, but all that was stuck in my head was the song from Best Summer Ever. And I feel like that was really a way to reinvent and recreate, and it sticks with you. And I wanted to kind of go to Rickey and Shannon. First of all, you do incredible work here as far as just your creative interpretation of everything. Shannon, your voice is unbelievable. And I think, you know, at first we're kind of experiencing you as an actress and have these really cute, great, funny punchlines. But then you have your song that you're singing and is so moving and so beautiful. And I think it like gives extra layers to the film. And Rickey, I mean, your dance and how that sort of bursts throughout the film. And at first I think you get a little bit exposed to it, but as the film continues, it comes across even more. I was actually wondering, what was it like for you, and I know this was a choice for the film, to kind of stage this in high school? This is kind of an early stage in life. I know this is, you know, light and fun and more, you know, and a time that people are kind of used to see musicals set in, but yeah. But I think it does have sort of a statement as far as this is when identities are being formed. Yeah. So how did you kind of accommodate your portrayal of your characters in that time of life?
But it was very interesting trying to go back to that time, because as an actor, I always have this thing where it's like, when you're in high school, it's hard to play high school, but it's about, I guess, having that perspective. I've been out of high school for a little while now, not that long, just a little while. And I appreciated being able to revisit some of the things maybe I felt were like huge in my life in high school, like who you're gonna ask to prom, or who's saying what about who, like little things like that. I feel like I was able to, I guess, find similarities between me and the character that I was portraying, me and Tony Michaels, and connect some of the very real high school moments that I went through and infuse that into my character. And you're right, it's high school is one of those.
Oh no.
Wow, Rickey, we got a phone call, sorry about that. Amazing timing. But everything in your life feels like it's the hugest thing in the world. And I wanted to make sure that was, or I tried to make sure that was felt within Tony Michaels as he's dealing with his issues with Sage, and as he's dealing with things with the coach and trying to become, you know, the man that he knows he can be and trying to find freedom. Yeah, the high school component to it was key for me, being able to infuse that emotion, that real emotion into it, at least try to.
Absolutely. And Shannon?
Well, first of all, thank you so much for all those very, very kind things that you just said about me. That was so nice. As for being in high school, you know, I'm very old, so it was very awkward for me. I had to watch a lot of 90210. I don't know. I think that the way that I kind of got into it was just thinking that, like, you know, in high school, every single thing is so heightened. Like, every moment of your life is the worst or best moment of your whole life. And I think I tried to approach it from that aspect. No one's going to believe that I'm 16 years old. But hopefully I got some of the essence fused in there a little bit.
For sure. I think everyone kind of, what kind of comes from the film is everyone is kind of a little bit insecure about what the right thing is and what they should be doing. And that definitely came across and came together. And that kind of actually brings me, Andrew, to you. So you were the screenwriter as well and were involved in coming up with the story. So yeah. Really, what was the decision of setting it at high school?
First of all, every actor in every high school movie is like not in high school at all. If you go back and watch Grease, that's the most of a play story. So, that's not enough. It was when we were writing the movie, so much of our community enjoyed the type of movie, like High School Musical and Grease. So I think it was more of a comfort zone thing of staying through to the genre of what we like to write and emulate. I mean, personally, when I play a movie, I try to emulate movies that I admire. But it was a very collaborative Mike and Warren and Will to let me pick the movie as well. It was very much a decision based on what we were trying to emulate.
I wanted to address the fact that, you know, your film features a lot of characters, some of them with disabilities, some of them without disabilities, but the disability itself is not addressed in the film in any way. I tried to actually look and I didn't see any mention or discussion about it. And I think that is a very interesting choice to have. What was the reasoning behind that?
So many films and shows about disability. When you have disabled characters in a show, so much of the plot is driven by what the disability is and what caused the disability. And you know, it's very rare that you get a movie with disabled characters who happen to have disability. So, part of what our goal was with the show that people with all kinds of disabilities can play this archetype role, like the carrier. And football players, and features, and roles that they would probably never get cast in otherwise. It's really a reflection of life. We definitely overcompensate in the movie. When people watch the movie, how are all these famous people in this one town? Is there some animal? What? It was like we tried to get it like in your face and a basketball. The more you show the type of role, the more normalized it becomes.
Like, just to piggyback off of what Andrew said, just the beauty of this is like one film that I've worked on where this the inclusivity of it was pretty magical, and the fact that disability isn't mentioned in the movie It just normalizes the fact that it literally doesn't matter how you look, where you come from, what your abilities or lack thereof is. You can carry a movie, you can create dynamic stories, you can have an amazing time on screen, and you can portray that real emotion. And this is a good message for Hollywood, because it's, I feel like it's been a gray area for so long. And it's beautiful to see this movie sort of fill that role and show people that movies can be great. It doesn't matter how the person looks. It matters about the drive and the passion and the talent.
I think what's great about Best Summer Ever as well is, like, piggyback that, like, it sends a message to the industry that, like, this format can be applied to any script. You know, it's not like we came together and we're like, okay, we're going to write a disability focused film. We just were writing a story, you know, and we came together and put that together. And I think with it, it's really like you have a story, you have a script, and then you just figure out the inclusive casting and the inclusive crewing, you know? And so I think people who see this, we hope, like, will take that away, that, like, we don't have to have, when we're making these types of movies, it doesn't have to be so focused on ability or inner ability or cross ability. It's like, it's just about making stories and having an inclusive cast and making sure that that representation is there, which I think is really exciting.
Yeah, and I think that so many times in the industry, when you're trying to make something, the decision makers really have to see that it's been done. And there's a lot of questioning of, well, show me it. And so I think with that decision in particular, I think we were just really trying to say, okay, we'll show you. We would love to see more people getting in front of casting directors for characters that don't have anything to do with their disability, because that opens up such a more wide range of possibilities for actors. And that's the place that we need to be getting to.